Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about solubility.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We now know what a solution is, so we want to know how to determine whether two substances will be miscible or immiscible. That is, whether they will or won't mix to form a homogeneous solution. We must also understand that there is a limit to how many solute particles can fit in a solution of a given volume, because there are a certain number of interactions a solute particle must make with solvent molecules in order to dissolve. And once all the solvent molecules are occupied and making such interactions, the solution is said to be saturated, meaning no more solute can dissolve and join the solution. If more solid is added, it will just sit at the bottom, and there will be a dynamic equilibrium where solute particles leave solution to join the solid at the same rate that particles leave the solid to join the solution. The solubility of a solute is the amount that dissolves in a given quantity of a particular solvent at a given temperature. For example, these substances will dissolve in 100 grams of water to the extent shown at the indicated temperatures. A supersaturated solution is one that contains more solute than a saturated solution. This can happen when a solution is prepared at a very high temperature where solubility is heightened and then allowed to slowly cool. This is a very unstable situation, so any disturbance causes immediate precipitation. Let's look at what causes a discrepancy in solubility between different ionic solids. First, we must ask the question, if an ionic solid is held together by ion-ion forces, the strongest intermolecular force, why would they want to dissolve? One version of the answer includes a concept called entropy, or the tendency to go towards more disorder. But we will get to that later. For now, the answer is that each ion can participate in a number of ion-dipole interactions in solution, which could potentially add up to store more energy than there is in the solid lattice. If this is the case, the substance will likely be soluble. We have to compare two values for any ionic solid, the hydration energy and the lattice energy. The hydration energy is the energy that results when a network of ions maximize interactions with solvent particles. Lattice energy is the energy that holds the solid lattice together. Whichever one is greater will determine whether the substance dissolves or not. So here is sodium chloride as a solid, and here we have dissociated ions making ion-dipole interactions. How do we calculate these energies? It can be tricky to do experimentally, so we actually calculate lattice energy indirectly by using something called the Born-Haber cycle. First, we use heat of formation data to show the change in enthalpy related with going from elemental sodium and chlorine to sodium chloride. There's the delta H for the reaction. Then, separately, we find the enthalpy change associated with first vaporizing and ionizing sodium, and then splitting chlorine molecules into individual atoms and ionizing those, until we have individual sodium and chloride ions not interacting with each other. Wherever that sits on the energy diagram, the distance to NaCl solid, where they are interacting, must be the energy stored in the interactions, or the lattice energy. Just look at tabulated data like this, and if the hydration energy of a substance is greater than the lattice energy, it should dissolve, as it will be energetically favorable for it to do so. We can also just refer to this handy table and memorize the compounds we know to be water insoluble. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.